Hey,
let me make you a host right now.
Thank you. And I think Shane's going to be the one who will share our slides, but it'll all work.
Right. I'd like to welcome everybody to our third workshop with the Science Policy and Engagement Workshop Series. This workshop is all about using multimedia, and we have primarily Olivia Ambrolio, I hope I'm saying your name last name correctly, Olivia, and Shane Ambrosio. Ambrosio, right, from the Sharing Science Department within the AGU. And I think we'll advance one slide and then I'll turn it over to the two of them. So just to give everybody a little bit of framing, the Science Policy and Engagement Workshop, or cohort, as you all know, is kind of special because we're testing a lot of new engagement and policy tools to help your projects have greater impact. The last workshop was all about getting the ball rolling. We talked about communications plans, about how to announce your project, about how to think about milestones, what they are, how to document them. Our next workshop, which will take place June 23rd, and I'll cover that more at the end of this presentation or workshop, will be about mobilizing your community. And we'll have several community leaders who have a lot of experience in this field, as well as several external experts who work in various realms of community mobilization as part of that workshop. And then in July, we'll have some journalists and politicians also present to talk with you about exactly what they need to hear from you. So without further ado, I'd like to turn it over to Shane and Olivia.
Thanks, Sarah. I think let's have a little bit more ado because both Liza and Shane are new to this group. So Liza and Shane, do you mind just introducing yourselves for a second so people know who you are before we get into everything?
So I'll go first. Hi. Oh, we both jumped at the same time. Sorry, Shane.
Go, Liza.
Hi, my name is Liza. I work in the AGU's Media Relations Office, or the liaison to the Thriving Earth Exchange program as a whole between us and our broader communications. And then our core work is working with our scientists to help explain their results and their research to the media and to the general public. So excited to talk to you guys about what you're doing.
And I'm Shane Hanlon. I work in sharing science with Olivia, doing stuff like this on a daily basis. From the multimedia perspective, my expertise is really audio and video. So you'll get to see a little bit of that coming up.
Thanks, both of you. Okay, so we have a lot of material, as Erin mentioned. So I'm going to try to go through things fairly quickly, but obviously, please feel free to put comments or questions or additions or concerns or what have you in the chat at any time. So as you're thinking about developing some kind of multimedia for to share around your projects, you want to really think about these things that we've talked about in other contexts as well around communication, right? Who is the audience that you're trying to reach with this? What kind of goals do you have around creating this multimedia? Is it for entertainment value or to raise awareness, to reach more broadly? Or are you hoping to have some kind of call to action related to that? And what kind of success are you looking for and how can you really measure whether or not you've achieved that? We're gonna hit upon four different types of multimedia. Obviously there are many more, but these are sort of broad areas that we think are pretty relevant for sharing, especially if you're thinking about the social media and online realm as so many of us are on right now. So I'll talk a little bit about drawing to begin with. So you wanna think about what story you're telling with drawing, not just because that will help you convey what you're trying to convey better, but also because it will tell you what kind of resources you need. So for example, if I was telling a little story about barnacles and how they're all simultaneous hermaphrodites, I might need reference photos or to go to some site where I could refer to them if I wanted to draw a more kind of accurate picture. Or if I'm just doing cartooning, then I don't need to refer to anything except my own memory of beats and my imagination. Similarly, if you're trying to really document elements of a project, are you going to need special kinds of equipment for when you're drawing whatever you're drawing? Will you need to also have something to demonstrate scale? Will you need to make sure that you have something with you that's okay if it gets wet? Just sort of these typical kinds of things that you want to consider as well. And also for both drawing itself and for other kinds of multimedia that you might be doing, you want to think about storyboarding. So for example, maybe I think, okay, in the first image or visual, whether it's video or drawing or photos, I want to show this location that we're at. Then I want to show people doing the thing at this location. Then I want to show what's being done with whatever was collected from that location later. And then I want to show what was found out based on all of that. And those are the kind of images I want. We also have some references, and I think I'll put this in a link in the chat later, but if you're interested in doing animations to kind of convey a message, there are some simple ways to do that. You can use PowerPoint, you can even use the corner of a notebook and take pictures of it to sort of bring it to life online or on screen. So there are some easy ways to make things even more dynamic, let's say, if that's something that you're interested in. And then, all right, Shane, I'll pass it to you.
Thanks, Olivia. Take this back. Okay, so next we're gonna talk about audio, going along again with the pre-production. This is just essentially planning, but what I think personally is really special about audio is that audio can really evoke visuals, right? It gets the, in this case, listener to create a scene in their mind. It's really bad at conveying scale, but it's good at conveying a sense or a feeling. Like, think about the phrase, the forest seemed to stretch on forever. And right. While forever looks like something, at least in our minds, very different to each one of us, we're at least all kind of sharing in this experience of imagining something, probably, even though what that something might be a smidge different. So just some considerations when thinking about any sort of audio, and I'm going to discuss kind of if you are from giving a presentation to recording audio, a bunch of different situations. But just something to keep in mind when we go back to, I assume when, we go back to being in person, doing live events in some capacity, there's always this question of whether to use a microphone or not. And the answer is always, yes, use a microphone. You should always use a microphone. It doesn't matter how loud you are. I am a very loud individual. My voice carries and projects very well. But if you are at an event where a microphone is available, use the microphone because you just never know. And with that, it's really important to think about just like how to use a microphone. And this might seem silly for some of you, but it's really important to know actually how to use some of this equipment. And so I do a lot, or at least I used to do a lot of presentations, do a lot of storytelling, different things. I'm always in front of a microphone. And the silly faces aside, microphones are this thing that we shouldn't be afraid of. We should be really close to them, right on top of them. We like to say, eat the mic. And that is okay because we can adjust those levels afterwards. Now, it's not always perfect, right? Like I, even someone like myself who does a lot of live performances and things like that, like I'm not perfect as well, but it's these small things that can make a big difference. Most of us though, probably at least now, or maybe even in the future, are gonna be more on, let's say, the recording end or just like this, right? In our virtual environment. And so there are things to keep in mind with recording as well. Across the board, good mic etiquette with okay gear is much better than bad technique with great gear. Meaning that if you are talking into a microphone in a way that like makes sense, if you're using good etiquette, if you're in a room, and my office isn't a great one for this, it has a bit of an echo, but if you're in a room that doesn't have a big echo, if you're doing small things with meh equipment, that's much better than having the fanciest equipment out there and not really knowing how to use it. Because if you do this work on the front end, then there's less work on the back end trying to edit things. And even some of the best editing software in the world can't get rid of some bad etiquette. And there's all sorts of tricks you can use no matter what your setup is. There's pop filters. So these are like they can be literally a screen that goes over your microphone or just things you wrap around your microphone to get rid of popping sounds, peas, it sounds really bad. a room print. You can record a few seconds before you start recording to get an idea of what your actual room sounds like. And that way you can edit out that sound. Like I said, eat the mic. There are a bunch of different resources out there. Transom.org has some really great ones. But just if you're thinking about recording anything, you can just Google this and hundreds of sites will pop up with audio information. We like to think about this in the podcasting world. So I and Liza and Olivia, we're all involved with AGU's Third Pod from the Sun podcast. I'm one of the hosts and a producer, and Liza and Olivia produce as well. And then I also am the executive producer and host of Scientel, another one of our podcasts. And I also work for an organization called Story Collider. So I have audio in my bones, but audio, specifically podcasting, is a really great way to communicate science, or frankly, communicate a lot of things, because it's economical to produce. Even with, again, just like meh equipment, you can make a really good podcast. It's convenient for listeners because they can just get it whenever they want to. It's inconvenient to get to subscribers, so people just, it gets downloaded onto their app or whatever it might be. And going back to this idea of intimacy, it's right in folks' ears. Again, it's different, doesn't convey the scale, doesn't necessarily show you a thing, but it's really intimate. And that's what I really love about it. But it's not just about podcasting, for example. Sounds themselves can help tell stories. They can add to pieces, they can add to popular science pieces or maybe press releases. I know that we at AGU have put out some sounds with press releases that have gotten a lot of attention. And I'm just going to give you an example of one of those.
Hey, real quick, switching gears slightly. Anybody here fans of ominous portents of impending doom? Good. Great news for you. Because apparently, scientists have discovered a weird noise coming from the Antarctic ice shelf. Either that or one of the geophysicists down there just came up with a really lame excuse. Bob, did you just fart? No, that was the Antarctic ice shelf. Researchers discovered the sound by accident when deploying equipment to study the crust and mantle of the Ross Ice Shelf, and found high-frequency trapped seismic waves in the top couple of meters of snow, which manifested as strange spectral anomalies that escaped easy explanations. Yes, spectral anomalies, or in layman's terms, ice ghosts. Audience comes with their own sound effects. That's nice. That's how much money we just saved. But you don't have to take it from me. The team of scientists has isolated the audio and released this actual clip. Take a listen. I can't tell if that was seismic waves or the last Radiohead album.
So, not of all clips get picked up by Colbert, but this one did. One of our colleagues released it with one of our press releases, and it got featured in multiple newspapers, eventually got news outlets, got eventually picked up by Colbert. So you never know, right? Like something just as maybe silly or maybe seemingly trivial as a sound like that could be really important. Again, might not be the typical, but it's possible. And with that, I will turn it back over to Olivia.
Thanks, Shane. So yeah, as I also mentioned in the chat, we're going to talk about different elements of the process as you go through different types of multimedia. So this is more about planning. We're going to talk a bit about doing, tiny bit about what to do afterwards to edit what you're doing. Then we'll have some examples from the sort of press and policy world as well. So just to kind of preview all of that for you. For photography, you really, again, want to think about what kind of story, what kind of message you're trying to convey. And remember, too, that cameras see things differently than we do. So I'm sure everybody has had this experience where you take this photo that you think is fantastic, and then later you look and there's a telephone pole coming out of somebody's head. Or, you know, it's this beautiful tree and you're showing the picture to someone and like, what am I looking at? There are just all of these things in the image. And so remembering that cameras can't filter out other elements of the visual world the way that our eyes can. So being aware of that when you compose. I'll come back to this about cameras, but it's worth trying a bunch of things, especially now we don't have to worry about running out of film. You can really experiment with a lot of stuff with photography. And you know, I'm going to talk about some tips for how to think about, you know, taking images, but you can ignore anything so long as you're doing it deliberately. So I'll talk a little bit about these different elements of photography. First, you want to think about what is the subject of your picture? So is it the subject is an artist in their studio? So you're really trying to get a whole space because it is part of what you're conveying about the person? Or are you taking a picture, am I taking a picture of my cute dog and I don't want the rest of the room to be involved? I just want to focus on her. You know, how can you arrange things in the image so that people will linger longer over it and find it more dynamic and more visually interesting? You know, so that cave does a good job. This portrait of Louise Bourgeois by Annie Leibovitz is a great example, I think. You know, we have all of these textures in it. We have this dynamic motion that she's made. Our eye sort of moves from the face to the hand and back around and investigates all of those textures. You may have also heard about the rule of thirds. And this is this idea that if you divided an image into three, and then three again, so vertically and horizontally, you would want the most interesting images come where you put your subject at one of the intersections, so like where this tree is within that image. Because when you place something in the center, it's just, it doesn't have as much power. So this photo from Drag Queens on Ice that I took 1 year in San Francisco, again, you sort of see where our eye is drawn, and that makes the image more interesting than if you put the subject sort of right in the center or way off to a side, which can actually make people feel a little uneasy. This is a really great photo that uses a lot of this. You see how even the lines of the street are sort of drawing you in. You have this great expression on this woman's face, this delight. You know, we have this, a lot is going on, there's motion. The spray has actually obscured some of the background that would otherwise be distracting. It just combines a lot of elements really well. And, you know, editing is part of this too. You don't have to be thinking about rule of thirds constantly as you're trying to document something. You can come back later to your images and edit them so that they become a little more dynamic. Something else to think about is something like depth of field. This is how much of the distance is in focus. You can do this a little more easily with an actual camera versus a phone camera, but I'll talk a little bit later. There are ways to do it even with a phone camera. So again, this depends on what is your subject and what story are you telling? The image on the left, I just wanted to get that weevil. The image on the right, I wanted this picture of these animals within a city environment of New York. So I wanted to make sure that everything was at least somewhat in focus. You want to think about light and color. Both in terms of how accurately you're sort of delineating your subject and what kind of mood it's creating. So you see the person holding, I think it's Hale on the left. The light is a little harsh, right? It's much brighter on one side of the face than the other. Not so much that anything's obscured, but maybe, you know, if you're thinking about it more, you might've asked the person to move a little bit and you would have stood with the light source behind you so that it was shining more evenly on that person. In the middle image, we have these sort of blue colors, which are really great for this because that conveys the sense of cool and calm. And then the one on the right, you know, we have the sense of vastness. And there's this person who's just a silhouette, which is okay for this because it's not about that individual, right? It's more about a feeling of space. But do keep that in mind. If you have the light source behind your subject, make sure that you're doing that on purpose. You know, it's only good to have a silhouette if you meant to have a silhouette. And you may have heard about things like the golden hour in terms of taking photos. And this is really the time around sunrise or sunset when the light is slanting and it has that kind of golden cast. So there's a different color and it's sort of a different quality to the light that makes images feel a little more dimensional. So for example, oops, let me go back. Here's a photo of a horseshoe crab at midday. Now all of the details are there. It's fine for documentation purposes, but the light looks a little bit flat. This is the same, well, not the same horseshoe crab, a horseshoe crab in the morning. And you can see that this light has created this kind of luminescence and the crab itself looks as if it has a little more depth, even though it's still a 2D image. Now, this is not to say that you should only photograph during these times. Just be aware of whether you're on under bright light, whether you're in some kind of shade, you know, what the light is doing. So I took this midday and I think it worked out just fine. And then think about things, speaking of light, like reflections. Using reflections as part of your story is a really arresting way to draw people in to what's going on. And maybe it's not the only image for you to tell the story, but it can be a very effective kind of hook image to draw people in. And then timing is always going to be a big part of photography, right? And part of that has to do with knowing whatever subject it is that you're taking pictures of. Yes, like, you know, when people are going to be lifting something or moving something or looking happy, or, you know, something's going to fall, something's going to happen. But it also has to do with just taking a lot of pictures. So I really encourage that as part of the process too, is just taking a whole bunch of pictures from different angles and over a period of time to really get the ones that you most want. So if you're thinking about taking a lot of photos in one time, having an actual photo shoot, try to make a list in advance, you know, that whole storyboarding element. Think about things like, do I want shots that are really wide of the whole area? Do I want a lot of close-ups of a particular location? What kind of light am I going to want for it? What's the weather going to be like? So you want to look at your location in advance too. Is it going to be really crowded certain times of day? Is it going to be really shady certain times of day? What are you going to be looking for there? And then obviously you want to make sure that you have whatever equipment you might need. Although, to reflect what Shane was saying earlier, you don't need fancy equipment to make an interesting image. And with that, Shane will talk a little about video.
Right. So video is kind of the combination of all of this. It's moving pictures with sound, essentially. Because of that, it probably takes some of the most intense planning. The pre-production on video is a lot, because with video you have visuals that drive the story. If you don't have good visuals, it's not necessarily the right fit. Like, why are you using video? You could use audio instead, maybe. And you want to lead with the most interesting visuals, but having things be interesting doesn't necessarily mean that it's complicated. So really simple subject matter, and you want to be sure to have a plan going into that. We'll talk about storyboarding in a second, but be willing to change that plan. There's a lot of effort and a lot of time that goes into video specifically, and planning is really important. But with all of these different things, you got to be flexible, but video, you really got to be flexible. And so with video pre-production steps, again, more of the planning, there's the research and plan, and there's also creating a storyboard, which I'll talk about in a second. With all of these mediums, but especially again with video, thinking about who your audience is, before you put the time into making something, who is this for, what's their viewpoint, and what do you already know about the topic you're trying to convey to them? And why are you doing it? So why are you doing, again, any of these mediums, but why are you going to put the time, effort, energy, maybe money into video specifically? What are you trying to accomplish? Do you want to inform or entertain or motivate? Are you trying to call someone to action? Frankly, do you think the folks who you want to watch it will? Do you think you have that audience? How is what you're making different from already what's already done? And why is video the best medium for the story? This is not to dissuade any of you who might be interested in making any sort of videos, but just know kind of going into it that it is a lot of work that can oftentimes be really great and pay off really well, but planning is really the name of the game here. With that, it's important to think about scope. So what exactly you're trying to create and how. With video, this takes all sorts of different forms. It could be like literally filming people, or it could be putting a collage of photos together or pictures. It could be illustrations or animations. It could be a whole slew of different things. Think about your story and who and what the subjects are of the video. What assets, so essentially what equipment do you have? Video is just like all these other things. Having a real big fancy camera is neat, but also not necessary a lot of the times. If you've ever seen any like iPhone commercial, the whole thing about that is that, hey, look at all these great things you can do with just your phone. And yes, it's a marketing tool, but frankly, for a lot of folks' needs, it's also true. Who is going to be in this video? Who's actually going to need, who you're going to need to talk to tell this story? Or else who also is in a project? Money's really important for any of these things. But if you have, if you're trying to plan some sort of big project, big video project, chances are you're going to need a production crew. That's going to cost money. Is there a budget for it? Thinking about when and where is especially important with, I'd say, photo and video, because time of day, especially if you are outside, makes a big difference. Because what it looks like, say, in my backyard at 8 a.m. is very different than what it looks like at 1 p.m. And then finally, what's your deadline? All these things take time. Knowing what you're up against is really important. You want to, like I said, research and plan. So that's your audience, purpose, scope, define your schedule. But then create a storyboard and, if needed, a script. And a storyboard is essentially what, there's an example here on your right, but this is just basically defining what ideas you want to convey and what visuals will illustrate them. So, okay, so I want this scene to open and we want to get this thing across. And this is the image or this is the video that I think I'd pair with that. And you can use it for a guide for capturing what footage you need and kind of what editing you'll need to do. Because if you're telling a story, chances are it's going to be a combination of shots, and knowing what those shots are going to be up front is crucial. And If you're having someone narrate, or if your video is going to be scripted, if you have, say, characters or people talking in it, think about whether you want in-screen or on-screen captions or someone narrating over. If you're just creating little short videos for something like social media, frankly, it's best to have both. A lot of people watch video without turning the sound on if they're perusing on their phone and they're in a meeting, honestly. Having captions is really helpful. Visuals and scripts, they should actually complement one another so that you're not essentially describing what you're seeing. Like, what's the point if the what you're seeing and what you're talking about are the same exact thing? And then read your script aloud before you finalize it, because how we read things is very different than how things are said and how things come across when said. And frankly, keep it short. And I don't necessarily mean the length of said video, but kind of. We use videos oftentimes for a lot of the marketing that we do, or just even to convey science communication concepts, and we try to keep them short because our attention spans are short. But just in general, if you can say something in a few minutes, what's the point of making a 10-minute video about it? And when you're planning your video, unless it's just like a really, no, I'd say for any videos, like I make 1-minute TikToks and I need to make kind of a shot list. So make a shot list, have it, figure out whether you have a variety of close-ups or wide shots or medium shots. Think about what you actually need to capture to tell your story. Like I said before, scout out your location and plan accordingly. If it's a kind of a static environment, say inside your house in a basement that you just turn the lights on, okay, you know that, you can do that anytime. But yeah, if it's outside, or if it's at a location that's not yours, or if you're visiting a public place, you need to know what it's going to look like at the time you plan on shooting. And then procure any equipment you might need. It could be something as simple as making sure you have your phone and that's it. Or it could be something really complicated, like a camera and mics and reflectors and boom stands and all sorts of stuff like that. And this is a legacy photo we have in here from one of our former colleagues. But this is true. This quote: "You're trying to tell a story. You really need to see some intimacy." I kept saying about how audio is a very intimate medium, but video again is pulling all this stuff together. And so you need to figure out why people are wanting to see what you're doing, why they want to listen to what you're listening to or what you're saying. And so all of this planning is so very important to do that. And then, Olivia, I will give it back to you as we move on to how to actually do these things.
Okay. So yeah, I think we'll, again, please feel free to put comments or questions in the chat. I think we'll go through the production, and then Shane, let's pause before post-production to see what questions people have as well. Or if people want to share what their experience with any of these, using any of these. So drawing is kind of great, right? Because all you need is some sort of drawing implement and some kind of substrate on which to draw. That said, you can get a lot more involved should you want to. And if this is something where you think this is really the means through which you want to share a lot of information. And as you do that, really, you just want to think of things that are going to be individual choice, but that again, it's just worth thinking about in advance. Like if you're going to be carrying a little notebook with you to draw things in, how big should it be? Both in terms of what's easy enough to carry around without being a burden, but also what's so small that you're not actually going to be able to write anything on anyway. What kind of weight or thickness of paper do you like? Are you going to be putting any kind of colors in it? Marker, watercolor, any kind of paint? You want something a little thicker? What kind of texture do you like in your paper? And is it easy to share? And I just mean by that, like, let's say you do want to then share whatever kind of drawings or illustrations you've made in the online realm. Do you have an easy way of taking a picture of it with your phone where the whole page will be clear, or scanning it, or what have you, that, you know, certain kinds of notebooks don't even open very widely? So just things to think about if that's something that you're going to be working with. Obviously, also, there are a lot of options for drawing on various kinds of tablets, which can be a lot of fun too. And with that, there are just tons of apps out there that will allow you to do a lot of stuff in this sort of digital illustration realm. I especially like Procreate and Taiyasui Sketches. Happy to talk more about apps with people who care about it, but also not going to get into my obsessive rabbit hole about them. But I also want to say, you don't have to, you know, get a degree in illustration to do something that's going to draw people in. So I have done some pretty good drawings of things, but the one that most people contact me about to say, hey, can I share this somewhere, is this doodle that I did with Sharpie on a piece of, printer paper, because it hit a nerve with people. So, you know, don't be afraid to do even stick figures if they still convey some emotion or some message that you really want to convey.
So back to audio as I pull back control. Audio is no different than any of these other ones when we're talking about hardware, and you can go really simple. And the cool thing about audio is that almost all of us already have something to record. We have a microphone probably in our pocket, or I guess at this moment, sitting on our desk or something like that. Or frankly, right now, our computers all have some sort of recording program. So you always have some sort of device where you can record things, and your phone or your computer that has a built-in microphone. Having said that, there are very quick ways to get a much better sound quality depending on what your mileage is. And so if you have, say, a phone, there's all of these little microphones that plug directly into your phone. I have one of these things. I use it a bunch. They cost like $50 to hundreds of dollars. And so you don't need that. But if like audio is your thing and you are recording a bunch on your phone, there are these small little adjustments and little add-ons you can get that will vastly improve what you're trying to do. If you want to get a little bit more professional outside of just something on your phone, even a phone mic, there are all sorts of different options. So there's these little voice recorders that are really popular with journalists. If you want like a dedicated thing to record sound onto, if you have if you want to go a little bit more professional with the studio mic, you can use a condenser mic. There's these unidirectional mics that are really popular on stages. This is actually what we use a lot of times in our podcasts. So there's a whole slew of different options out there. Again, if you are just dabbling in this, you have a mic on your phone, or you can get really, really fancy and there's lots of options there. In the computer environment, one of the more popular options is something like this. This is a microphone that plugs directly into your computer. Actually, it's what I have. Again, I do this for a living, but there's lots of different options for microphones out there. And yeah, if you just have your phone, that's fine. Even just like headphones, the microphone on your headphone is loads better than the microphone on your computer. So if you were just trying to get really good audio, if you just plug your headphones or if you have Bluetooth headphones in your computer, and you're trying to record yourself, the microphone on whatever type of headphones you have is a boatload better than just the recorder on your computer itself. So small little things that a lot of us already have can make a big difference. If you're recording, it's the same idea. So there's these big fancy setups and rigs with people with soundboards and compressor mics and external recorders and all sorts of different things. We have a handful of these little handheld recorders we use for the podcast that can record directly into it with these little mics on top. We can plug microphones into it. But again, at the end of the day, you can record things onto your phone or directly on your computer with native software and hardware, things you already have if you're just starting to dabble with thinking about using sound. And like I alluded to earlier, technique can be the bigger thing that matters. So this kind of blanket fort, if recording sound, if you literally put yourself like underneath a blanket or in a closet, I've listened to a lot of really well-done professional podcasts, especially during the past year when we've all been at home, where people who have won Pulitzers are recording out of their closet because that's the most sound sensitive or sound deadened room in their home. These little filters you see, these are pop filters. These things cost like 50 cents to, I don't know, $10, $15. Again, small little things that make a huge difference. And also, do not touch your microphone ever. The mic is lava. It's one of these things where it's kind of like the idea of a pop filter, except for your hands. Once your microphone is set up, don't touch it if you're recording on it, because getting rid of those sounds is really, really difficult. Good technique matters a lot. And I did the whole closet thing. So I was doing a lot of recording when we first got into the pandemic. And this was like the little setup I had in one of the closets. I would throw pillows around. It was just a storage closet. I have since moved. And again, I do this professionally. So I built myself a studio. Don't need this by any means. This one works just fine. But I have the luxury of doing this, and it's a lot of the work that I do. So I'm just kind of showing you all these things to show you kind of the gamut of all the different options that are out there. If you're recording, you can record remotely. We're recording this meeting right now. So Zoom is a type of software that we have all used because we're all on it right now. And you can record into Zoom, and the quality is not that terrible. There are also dedicated audio recording apps and software out there. So this picture on the right is of Squadcast. It's a dedicated audio recording service that we use. The software is just a little bit better, and it's made for recording audio. So we use that because it is a dedicated thing. But again, we all have Zoom. In person, you can just record things onto your phone. So if you have an iPhone, for example, you can go into Voice Memos, you click record, and you have a recording. So lots of options there. You can also record into dedicated softwares that you can either pick up for free for your computer or are already on there. So in the bottom left, if you have a Mac, you already have GarageBand, which you can record and edit and do a bunch of stuff with. On your right is a program called Audacity, which is a free program that I think every person who's ever podcasted has used Audacity at some time in their life because it's free, it's amazing, and it does a lot. So again, lots of stuff out there that you don't need professional, one, you don't need to pay for, but you don't need professional experience to use or to get involved in. And along that theme, I'll hand it back to Olivia.
Thanks, Shane. Okay, so a little bit more about photography. So going back to what we've sort of been reiterating throughout this, it is true that you do not need a fancy camera. I can attest to the fact that it is possible to take bad photos with any kind of camera, regardless of how fancy it is. And it's also true that a lot of the elements that make for an interesting photo, composition, use of color, point of view that you're at, what kind of subject you choose, at least some elements of light, these are all things that you can personally control, regardless of whether you have a phone or an actual camera, or you know what kind of camera it is. And finally, regardless, the best camera is the one that you have with you, right? So if you have a really nice camera, but you never actually bring it with you to places, then one, there's no point. But also, even if you have a nice camera, but all you have with you is your phone and you want to document something, just do it, because it's better to have those images regardless of what you're taking them on than not to have them at all. Again, and with smartphones, you have a lot of options, both in terms of the quality that they provide, but also how you can sort of separate your subject from a background. So maybe you can't do the same things with depth of field, for example, that you could do with a single lens reflex camera, but you can set up the subject at a distance from everything else around them so that they are separated that way from the rest of the environment. You can use portrait mode if your camera allows you to do that, which sort of blurs the background. You can put someone like against this brick wall so that it's a simple background that still sets them apart from it. So there are ways to still make use of these compositional choices, regardless of what method you're using. And just in general, for good photos, you want to focus on a person's face or eyes if you're taking a picture of a person or other creature. You want to make sure that you have as much light as possible. Again, take lots of different pictures from different angles and learn from what others do. So there are programs like 500px or Flickr where you can actually look and see a lot of people will share the details of the photo they took. So let's say you wanted to know, what shutter speed they were using or other details of the camera. You could find that out so that you could take a picture similar to them. And ideally, you want to include people in your images as you can and as it's relevant, because we as humans are kind of narcissistic in our viewing and we find those kinds of images more interesting. You want to try to show action and emotion. So people actually doing things or people experiencing awe or excitement or happiness or even frustration is more interesting. Showing scale is really great. You know, we'd have no idea what that glacier face size was if we didn't have these tiny little people in the image or this, drill. And you can play around with elements like other sorts of frames. So there are a lot of kind of natural frames that exist, right? That you can incorporate into your image to, again, just make it a little more visually interesting. If you're taking a photo shoot where you know you're going to be taking a lot of pictures of people, try to use reflectors if you can. And those don't have to be special things that you buy. You know that thing that you put over the windshield of your car so that it doesn't get as hot with the sun coming in? It has that metallic side to it. You can use that to sort of bounce light off of, and that can be a perfectly useful one. Also, rather than using direct sun, which again is kind of harsher on a face and casts more shadows, use open shade, which basically just means it's not a shadow right on the face, but it's a tree cover or something where the sun is not directly on you, but there's still a lot of light. And then Shane, video.
So with video, again, it's a lot about planning, even frankly, when you're doing it. If you're thinking about the visuals and the audio that you're going to use, so maybe you want to use stock footage. You can collect footage and still images all the time. Stock footage is essentially just you have it, and then you'll need it depending on whatever your project you're doing. Make sure with all of this stuff, frankly, but especially with video, that you have permission to use these things. And we'll talk about copyright free stuff and Creative Commons and things like that a little bit later. If you're shooting original footage, if you yourself are shooting it, you're not just pulling from different sources. Like I said, you have lots of options on how to do this. You have your smartphone. If you do have a fancy camera, like Olivia was talking about, like a DSLR or a mirrorless, they shoot video. And a lot of them shoot pretty darn good video. Or maybe you do want to have a professional camera. Lots of options out there. And as with these other types of multimedia, you might need additional equipment. So like Olivia was just saying, maybe reflectors, but yeah, you can use like the car shades. You might need different types of lighting. If you're pulling in video, you're probably going to want, if you can, an additional microphone. So it goes back to this planning point. Think about what you want, what equipment you have on hand, what equipment you might want to add. And also, like, back to the planning process, record a voiceover narration, if that's something, a voiceover or narration, if that's something that you desire. So some tips for an actual video shoot. So as you're doing it, make sure you vary your shots. So you have your establishing shots, close shots, etc. Play with time-lapse and slow motion. This is kind of like the transition animations for PowerPoint. Don't get carried away with this. You want to make sure that you're using these different types of effects to help enhance the story that you're trying to convey, not just as kind of, hey, neat, gee whiz, look at this. Make sure you collect B-roll and supporting images. This is, again, this is kind of like some of that stock footage. These are images or videos that you'll use in establishing shots. So here on the bottom left, this is from Seinfeld. So this is one of these shots that you could always tell, okay, they're in the diner. And this is B-roll, essentially. This is just a real quick footage that you could tell. It was an establishing shot to tell where they were. Try to have... If you're doing video, try to have some help if possible, even if it's just for just like help with lighting or just some of the mechanics of it, or even if you're trying to get a good interview, having some sort of assistance, even if that person is a friend or a colleague or a family member, whatever it might be, can make a boatload of difference. Understand staging. This is essentially just like where your shots are going to be, what's in the shot, how you want the shot to look. This is thinking about, again, what story you want to convey and what needs to be in the shot in order to help you convey that. And I've been saying that the equipment doesn't really matter. You can do a lot of really great things with little equipment. With video, an external mic makes a lot of difference. It really does. Not to say you can't get good videos without something like that, but even that that microphone I showed you that plugs into my phone, that little thing does a lot of work. And you can tell dramatically when I'm recording video on my phone, when I'm more than, gosh, maybe like more than a foot away from my phone, that little microphone does a lot to really pick up really good audio. So if you're thinking about like, okay, well, what's my starter kit for investing in things? I want to do some audio, some photos, and maybe some video. Like, what's the one thing? Personal preference, but for audio and video, like getting just one of these little plug-in mics, and there's a whole slew of them, and some of them are pretty cheap and do a lot of work. Like, it's a really good thing to have if you're thinking about diving into this world. If the type of audio, audio you're trying to collect and video you're trying to collect is an interview, this is for any sort of interviewing, and this might, Liza, I apologize if I'm stepping into your world at this point, but if you're conducting an interview for like a podcast or for on camera, make sure that you save all your good questions for on camera. You want the responses to be authentic. You want them to come across as not so scripted, not so mechanical, roboted. Ask open-ended questions so that the person that you're interviewing can actually be natural and come across as they actually speak versus yes, no, okay, whatever it might be. Recognize that cameras are weird and an intimidating presence in the room. I know we've been staring at screens for the past year plus, but a camera that will probably literally be right here staring at you is a little strange. And with that, just kind of be yourself, find moments of humanity in the interview, try to build a story around your interviewee. Feel free to guide them if you're trying to, like, you know that they do a certain thing and they can tell a certain story. You can help guide them. Interviewees do like direction. This isn't feeding words into their mouth by any means, but especially folks who haven't been interviewed before, it's a good way to really loosen things up, but also get the story that you want. And if you're doing the video thing, use over the shoulder shots. That's this Batman and Joker one you see, and that's what you see a lot of times with, think of like a 60 Minutes interview, and you have that shot where it's over the shoulder of the interviewer and you can see the interviewee's face usually. Use those photography tips like Olivia was talking about. Rule of thirds applies for video. Lighting applies for video. Showing action and emotion, showing scale, all of these things like video and photography and art and illustration, these are visual mediums. So you can use a lot of these same tips. And just an example of a really effective way to show scale that we like to show. So with this video, you have this kind of establishing shot. You're like, oh, I don't know where I am, but just some simple some simple captioning here. As we pan out, you can see the scale of this destruction, right? This is starting from this first individual that we had a close-up on. You can barely see them now. So video and photos can show scale really well. That's something that just audio alone can't really do. Some smartphone tips, since most of us probably shoot video on smartphone. Almost always, turn your phone. We have a tendency to take video like this. We should almost always be taking video like this. The exceptions are if you know where you want to share it, that's not conducive for that. So TikToks, I do TikTok videos for my job, strangely enough. They like this format. Instagram does a square format, so it doesn't really matter. So if you know that the place you're putting this video has a specific orientation, that's fine. But when in doubt, take your videos like this, because it's easier to cut off ends here than it is to cut off ends here. Use a tripod when possible, or even just if it's your phone, just lean it against something so you're not getting kind of that wiggle from our move. Even surgeons probably have a little bit of wiggle when filming something. And move, don't zoom. This applies for a smartphone the whole way up to the fanciest camera you have. If you can get close physically, get close physically. That distance, nothing can make that up. No optical zoom, no digital zoom can make that up. The closer you can get, the better when possible. And I'm not going to dive really deep into this, but just as an FYI, we hear about all these different perspectives, all these different settings, and 1080 and 720 and all of this different stuff. So just for reference, when you hear folks talking about different resolutions, so a DVD is this kind of 720, 480, HD ready, no one uses that anymore. What's most popular is this 1920 by 1080. You usually go by the second number. So 1080 is what a lot of our TVs come out in. And then we hear 4K these days, super fancy TVs, 4K. It's a wild resolution. And some things film in 4K. We had a colleague who had his fancy new camera and he was so excited. He was a videographer and he turned like the 4K setting on and he shot some things in 4K, but he realized, one, he didn't need it. And two, the file size was so big that he couldn't use it. He couldn't actually download it onto his computer because it wouldn't work. So just think about storage as well with any of this stuff. And just quickly for all of our phones, and this is for an iPhone, but Androids have similar things. You can go in to your camera settings and figure out what your camera automatically records at. This is for video, but you can do this for photo as well. You can figure out also what it's outputting these as, whether it's like a Apple does something weird. It's like an M4A or HK. Anyways, you can figure out what the actual output file is. There's different types of files. Most of them are pretty standard, but you can really start messing around with this stuff if you're really interested in it. Again, like I said, a phone can do a lot, and especially on this far right one, you can actually see it tells you what would be best for different scenarios. There's lots of different resources out there for learning about photo and video. You can rent different equipment. So we do this actually with some of our microphones, and I think Olivia has, and I know some of our other colleagues have used some of these services to rent things. It's nice to try things out as well. Like, oh, I don't want to really commit to this, but maybe I want to try a fancy camera or a lens or a microphone or whatever it might be. Lots of great places to buy different equipment. I was talking about Creative Commons earlier. So on the left, these are some places where you can get sound effects. You will or may have to pay for some of these things. On the right, there are places where you can get images, stock footage, and graphics. I will mention that anything you get from the federal government, so we use NASA photos, or we've even used sound before, or whatever. If you're using images or video or photos for educational purposes, if you're not trying to make a profit off them or anything like that, they're in the Creative Commons. You can use those. And there are ways to search for photos via Google, just in the image search, where you can just click a setting and it says, for Creative Commons use. And you still attribute all of these things, but you can use them, especially if you're not, or if you're not using them to make any money, which most of us aren't. We're just using them usually for educational purposes or informational purposes. And with that, I will hand it back to Olivia to go over the last step of this process. Oh, and we want to maybe take questions.
Yeah, right? You know what, Shane, let's do you mind closing the slides for now? Let's take some questions and then we can see, maybe we'll just, depending on how people feel, we can skip the post-production and just talk about ways to share these products, depending on how much information people want.
So this is Marilyn, and I'm a super, super practical person. So this is, I'm going to ask you a really practical question. So this has been amazing. I wish I had your skills, and I wish I had a budget. So my question is, I'm a volunteer on the project, and comms is going to be, is what my job is on the project that I support. And I have a full-time job. So there's no way I can do the things that you're talking about. I mean, I can see some, there are things that I took from here that I can actually use, but I can't be you guys, in the near future, maybe in my next life. But, do you have recommendations for people who are resource constrained? I know about Creative Commons and this stuff. This is part of what I already do, but what would you recommend to people who don't have access to you?
Oh, those are great questions. I think partly if you're on part of a larger team, you know, some of it you can ask others for assistance with. And I'm not saying like, you know, for some sort of big project where you're envisioning creating a documentary or something, right? Obviously that's beyond what your scope is. But if you have other people on it whom you can say, hey, are you documenting things? Can I have a bunch of photos? And then if you have the time to even just share those via social media, or if you have a website on which you can create just a slideshow that people can go through or something like that, you know, even if you don't have the time or the means to document all the aspects, potentially bringing those together from different people at least allows you to have a kind of larger pool from which to share things as and when, you know, you have the time to do it. But Shane, do you have other advice?
I'm just thinking about tools. So, and since we're not going to go, we might not go into this other part. So there are some nice kind of, I'm talking and typing, but drag and drop things that folks can use that we use a lot, that even though we have access to some of this fancy stuff, we don't use it. So yeah, one of them is called Canva. It makes really good looking stuff, and it's drag and drop, and it's a relatively low barrier to entry, and it's free. Right. And it can take a lot of time, but to create really good stuff, it doesn't have to.
I'm also aware of a tool called VizMe.
Okay, yeah, that's one. If you're looking for audio visual stuff, there's another one I popped in called Headliner, where you can create short videos. We use it to create what we call audiograms, which are we'll show you in a second, but are static images with audio laid over it. It's also a free tool up until a point per month, but it's also a lot of drag and drop, that type of thing. Those are two that we rely on pretty heavily, even though, yeah, I also like have complete access to the Creative Suite. So yeah, just because we have access to these things doesn't necessarily mean they are the best tools. And I think just finding and freaking PowerPoint is a really great tool, which sounds ridiculous, but you can create some really beautiful things with PowerPoint and save it as a picture or overlay audio on it or import video into it. And so a lot of the stuff we're already using can be used as well.
And PowerPoint too can let you create GIFs, you know, so small animations. If you create a different image per slide, it will let you, like each of those slides is a frame essentially. So even if you're doing something like you've made a stick figure, you know, related to the project, and you just have it wave or something, you know, ideally that doesn't take a ton of time. And then you have created a little animation that you can use ideally to share, you know, in whatever way that you're trying to just raise more awareness about the project.
Super, thank you.
And I'll just chip in and say another kind of practical aspect is, you know, I think even if you don't have something that looks like a really polished, high-end kind of product in the end, just including photos or a quick audio snippet or a quick little video that you did on your phone, it's just 10 seconds long and just, you know, one single shot. I think any of that can really make something much more captivating and exciting to your audience. So I would say, don't worry about, you know, being able to spend a lot of time or effort or making things really perfect. Go for it and just add that little something that's going to catch someone's eye or give them a deeper insight into what you're doing. And I think it'll be helpful regardless of how professional or polished it might be.
So if there aren't other questions at the moment, or are there other questions? I want to make sure. I don't want to assume.
I actually have a question.
Okay.
And I apologize if you covered this already when you were talking about the microphones. So we got a really nice microphone that attaches to our camera, but it seemed when we were doing interviews, it's recording every sound when we're outside or if there's other people around. So would it be a better benefit to get a microphone that a person wears? And if so, what would be the benefit then of this nice microphone that attaches to your camera? I mean, it was great. It captured the sound everywhere, but it's hard to get it to focus on what you want, if that makes any sense. Like this person instead of this other person.
Yeah. Some microphones are basically, they're called omnidirectional, and you're right. They just pick up everything. Sometimes there are settings you can mess with to change that. But to your point, something like that's really good for if you are trying to pick, if that's your goal, right? If your goal is to pick up, or maybe audience sounds, or if you're at a big event, or if you're trying to pick up nature sounds or something like that. So even though it might not be what you're interested in using it for right now, one of those things could be really beneficial for something else. But a lavalier mic that you said, yeah, something that just pins to someone's chest, those are super great. And there's a reason why we've been using for quite some time in news media and in presentations and everything else. And usually they're not too expensive either. So yeah, if you can get your hands on one of those, I think that's what we would usually use, again, with our big fancy camera. We have one of those fancy mics, those like boom mics. But for the most part, we just clip a lavalier mic. Then these are the ones for folks to just clip on your shirt or your pocket or something like that. So I'd suggest get one that will help solve this immediate problem. But I bet that other mic is it could be something that has a lot of functionality, and it's just one of these things you might have to mess around with. Or could it come in handy down the road for something else?
I appreciate that. Thank you.
Sure.
Okay. If we don't have more questions right now, let me ask a question of you all. We do have a little bit that we could talk about, Shane and I, around what we call post-production. So essentially editing of the products that you've gotten. Or we can just move along to talking a little bit about means of sharing. We're going to talk a little bit about it through social media. Liza's going to talk a little bit about sharing it to the press, to the media. Liz is going to talk a little bit about sharing multimedia products for policymakers. How do people feel? Do you want to know more about that sort of post-processing? Or would you rather that we just, you know, maybe send an email, follow up with some information and move on to how these things can be shipped?
Olivia, do you want to give a little detail on what kind of that post-processing post-processing is for the various types of things, because that's a term that's new to some people.
Sure. So this would be various kinds of editing related software typically. So Shane will talk a little bit about ways in which then to edit like the audio that you've developed or video, you know, which software one can use. I'd talk about that for photography, sort of the ways in which it can happen for drawing. So if you want to know a little bit about those kinds of programs, we're happy to address it. Or if not, we don't have to. A little bit, okay. All right, Shane, let's just blast through this then.
No, that's not what I wanted. All right, hold on.
Okay.
Sorry, I was scrolling through to skip past it. All right. All yours.
All right, thank you. So this is pretty easy with drawing, because editing a drawing, well, did you draw with pencil? Then look, you can erase it. That makes it very simple. There are also, you know, obviously more complicated things. There are these certain kinds of pencils called photo blue pencils, where they look blue. And there's something that you can use if you know that you're gonna use a scanner or a copier or something. They will not show up there. So let's say you want to do your initial draft of whatever you're drawing using that, and then draw over with ink or some other thing. You don't have to erase every single pencil mark, because that, you know, non-photo pencil won't show up in those other circumstances. So just something to consider as well. If you're using any kind of drawing app, you have all sorts of options involved as you're kind of building whatever you're making, things called layers, where, you know, you can have one layer that's just for your line drawing. You can have another layer that's for all of your colors, another layer for all of the shading. You know, it allows for a lot of options. You can duplicate, you can cut things, all kinds of stuff, should you wish to. But again, you don't have to. And just thinking about it from a sharing perspective, when you have images, really use a scanner if you can, rather than taking a picture of what you've drawn if it's a physical thing, just because that typically takes a better picture. However, there are apps even for your phone that are called mini scanners that will do a much better job of reproducing this image in a way that looks even. You want to have some kind of signature or watermark on it so that people know whom to attribute it to and know that it's your own product. And know the permissions of the platform you're using. So are they allowed to just share what you've shared without attributing it to you or without even necessarily knowing? And just thinking about resolution too, because for a lot of social media, you actually don't want the image that you're sharing to be very high resolution. They want it to be lower to share it. And then Shane, let you talk about audio.
So with audio, you can do a little bit on your phone. So if you have, again, this is just in that Memos app for on an iPhone, but essentially with something like this, you can trim it. And that's about the extent that you can do it. So you can make sure that there's nothing on the front end or the back end and just shorten it to get rid of some of the extraneous audio. There's, if you have an iPhone, you have iMovie automatically installed on your phone. Within this, there's a little bit more you can mess with. You can mess with pitch and control, things like gain. You can record directly onto your phone and mess with some of these different controls. It actually does have recording on it. I never know if it's going to play sound. But again, this is more for recording like instruments and singing, but it also just works for recording any sort of audio. Once you record something, you can then go back in and kind of mess around with different levels. You can fiddle with all of these different things. And again, this is on an iPhone. This is what comes with it. There are Android analogs out there, but a lot of them don't come native. So doing things on your phone, you have a little bit of leeway and flexibility to do it, but not a ton. The caveat I'll make is in some apps, maybe TikTok, definitely TikTok, maybe something like Instagram. You can do a little bit of audio editing as well. What I do and what a lot of folks do is on your computer. So you basically will just share this audio recording via email. You can copy and send it or save it to Dropbox or something like that, and then go onto your computer. This is a screenshot of Audacity. It's one of those recording programs I told you about. It's free. It has a lot of really great guides. So I just upload audio into this and edit it from there. I now use Audition because, again, I do this for a living and it's an Adobe product, but it's the same idea. So taking files, putting it in there, mixing. There are lots of places to get music and sounds and all sorts of different things. There's some great lists out from Buzzsprout, which is all about audio. You can learn about copyright and Creative Commons. And these are some links that we can provide you all with afterwards. If you are hosting audio, specifically hosting something like a podcast, SoundCloud is a really great place to do it. There are other services with silly names like Blueberry and Lisbon. These are essentially like servers where you host audio and then you can distribute it from there. That's how we do it with our podcasts. We route them through our websites and you can just use websites to host different content, or maybe you just want to put it up on social media. That is fine as well. There's lots of places online. We also have a SoundCloud account. So SoundCloud is free up until a point as well. So basically, depending on what your effort, time, commitment, money, whatever it might be, there are lots of places to host and get your audio out there, depending on what your goals are and depending on kind of what you have to do it. And then I'll give this back to Olivia.
Thanks, Shane. Okay, so with photography, you know, there are a lot of things out there, and I'm just going to briefly touch on a couple of them. But, you know, again, as with many things, it's better to have taken a pretty quality shot to begin with than to try to fix it later. Now, there are certain things you can definitely fix, like lighting issues you can fix. Even things like, oh, I took a picture inside and it looks really orangey, you know, you can fix that. You want to change the composition by cropping the image, you can fix that. But if it's blurry, if it's really, really dark, and it becomes grainy, you can't do a lot about that. So just being aware. So Lightroom is free. But there are also, you can of course buy things. So that's a good way to use on a computer if you have like some kind of digital camera that you're using to get images from that you can edit. And then for your phone though, Snapseed is a free app which actually lets you do quite a lot. So they have things, they have filters that you can use that are much like, you know, lots of social media offerings, but they also have, in addition to filters, they have tools which will let you do a lot of stuff. So you can change the light levels, you can change what's called the white balance. You know, that's that thing where if you're taking a photo inside and it's orangey, they can fix that for you so that the tones look right. They can, you know what, I won't go into all the details, but you can do a lot of stuff is what I'm trying to say. So you can let them sort of choose for you via filters, or you have a lot of tools, so you have options for yourself for how you want to alter the image. So I really recommend that. I actually learned about it from our former colleague, Lauren, and I've used it quite a bit since, and I really like how it gives you more control over your phone images. Shane? Oh, you're muted.
See, mic mute, I should know this, mic mute versus system mute messes me up once in a while. So thank you, Olivia. With video, you need to be thinking about, if you have a bunch of different shots with video, a bunch of different films or a bunch of different audio and video and photos, make sure you have everything organized really well. This is almost a pre-production step because it's really easy for things to get really messy pretty quick. You want to arrange everything in an order that makes sense, make sure the script makes sense, make sure your voiceover, and then also figure out where you want to publish and distribute things. We'll talk about that in a second with social media. There's a lot of words on this slide, but the things to kind of keep in mind are these three big points. So make a rough cut. That's go through, create your video, and it's a rough draft, essentially. Okay, so now you have an idea of where everything is. Then you make a fine cut, which is essentially adjusting things where everything kind of makes sense and you're ready to show this to the world, but maybe it just needs a little bit of tweaking. And then you have that final cut. So it's kind of like the saying, measure three times, cut once, or whatever it might be. That's the same idea, especially with video. Like once you make that final cut, you can go back, but it's a lot of effort. There's lots of different options to do editing. So on an iPhone, iPad, you have like just in your camera roll, you can trim clips, you can make slow motion. And you have an iPhone, you can do iMovie. There's another one there used to be a really great Windows version. I forget what it's called, but they don't make it anymore. So we've actually been left a long time with a really good Windows version. I literally, as we were talking, forgot to add this in there, but there's one called Lightworks, which I'll put a link in the chat at some point. That's supposed to be like the best free one out there right now. That's for all systems. So I'll make sure I drop that in for folks as well. If you have pro software, if you can do it, Premiere Pro is really good. Or if you have access to the Adobe suite, Premiere Rush is amazing. I make all of my videos in Premiere Rush. It's essentially drag and drop. It's really quick. Again, if you don't have access to these things, there are free options out there. I mentioned Headliner before when answering a question, but Headliner is really great because you can do, you can create these things called audiograms, which we'll show you in a second with audio and still shots. It's really flexible. It creates really cool things and it's also free. And then, like I just said, Premiere Rush is a really great option if you have it, but if you don't, that's okay. There's lots of free things out there. And with that, I think we're going to briefly talk about how we share things on social media and then kick it to our colleagues. Olivia, you want to do this one and that can run us through the examples?
Sure. So now that you have these products, okay, what are you going to do with them? Are you sharing them on various social media platforms or a single one? Which ones are you choosing? What do you need to know about it? You know, again, some of this has to do with the planning, as Shane was talking about, what orientation you've taken pictures in and so forth. And then again, where are you disseminating it so as to fulfill the goals that you thought about earlier? Do you know that you're going to be reaching your target audience through this means? Or are you going to try to sort of disseminate very widely to reach a variety of audiences? Do you know that you're going to be able to achieve, if you have a call to action, get to it through whatever you're sharing? So are you going to make sure that there's some kind of link connected to whatever product you're sharing so that you can say, oh, was this exciting? You know, click here to learn more, or click here to do this, or click here to write your congressperson, whatever it is. Do you need to use a hashtag, either use one that's already existing because you're trying to jump onto a zeitgeist, let's say, or are you trying to create a hashtag because it's part of a campaign or something that you want to be able to be searchable later? And again, thinking about what those successes are going to look like as relates to how you're sharing your multimedia.
And then just some examples of ones that we've either done or folks we know who are doing it well. So there are scientists out there who share things about doing field work that have nothing to do with the field work, whether that's what's the specific type of hot sauce that Antarctic researchers take down there because the food is so bland or whatever it might be. It's how they show their personality, or folks that have to do helicopter ditch training when they're going to remote field sites, they need to figure out what happens if the helicopter they're flying in actually goes down. There's really great ways to show personality. These examples from Kim Cobb and Don Wright, really getting into aspects, just again, still images or a shot of a Lego figure, but tells you a lot from the still image and tells a story even without this really kind of much longer process, what we usually think of stories. Some examples from one of our colleagues. So on the left, some of you may have met Nancy, who's our colleague in media relations, but she went out on a research vessel and had to do their version of ditch training. So had to get in this Gumby suit. And so just telling a story about things that folks don't usually see when it comes to research. What do people pack for research experiences when they're going to be out in the field for weeks, if not months at a time? And then some of Olivia's drawings. So Olivia draws a lot of different things, but some of her most popular stuff for AGU at least is are these Valentines that she draws every year. And again, just like quick little fun drawings, but they get a ton of engagement and they tell a story. And also sometimes just trying to inform that Olivia just wants everyone to know that snails make their own shells, because not everyone seems to know that.
But they do. They really
do. And then just with kind of incorporating sound and video. So I've been talking about these audiograms. This is an example of what we do for our podcast. We'll just play a smidge of this.
For me, I think the biggest hurdle is communication skills, surprisingly. Coming from like a first generation grad student background, because I'm the first in my family to go to grad school, being a teen mom, and having some communication difficulties. A few months ago, I found out that I'm autistic. And now a lot of things are starting to make sense.
And so we do these clips that are under 1 minute, and they pull out a piece from our podcast. And then we have an illustrator who draws these really beautiful illustrations of our interviewees. And there's just, it's connecting a few things together, and it helps tell at least part of a story. Or if you're trying to do a video, just to play a little bit of this one.
My name is Kaya Riverman. I study ice caves in order to understand how water cuts from the surface of glaciers to underneath the ice, where it can have an impact on glacier dynamics. I'm particularly excited about describing how waterfalls migrate within glaciers.
And so this video here is just a collection of still shots with a narration over it, but you go through the whole thing, like it's really engaging, lots of really great shots, and Kaya is a good narrator. So lots of different ways that you can combine these things to tell a compelling story by just combining relatively simple elements into this larger picture. And
for me, I think...
Let me go through. Okay. And with that, I think... Does anyone have any... Do we want to do... questions? Are people monitoring questions? Some are. Okay. Liza, I will give you control to let you go through multimedia in the media.
Oh, okay. Exciting. So does this mean I can drive the slides? How is that going to?
Yeah, I think you're going to click twice and then you should be able to.
And it'll advance for me. Great. Okay. Well, hello, everyone. I went too far. Can I go back? How do I go back, Shane? We clearly practiced.
There.
That was the one I wanted. Thank you so much. Okay, so I'm Liza, and I work in media relations, as we mentioned at the top. And when you're working with the media, the first and most important thing that you want to think about is whether you have permission to share the images that you want to share with them. And the best way to know that you have that permission is to make it yourself, as we've been talking about today. So these two images here, are neither of them are done by professionals. They were both shot by scientists who were working on a study that was about using bat poop to as a record of climate change. So that was a fun story. And so both of these pictures are telling you something about that story. They're telling you immediately they're about bats. They're telling you that it's about caves. It's giving you that kind of more visual hook. And a lot of times that visual hook can really help you get a story, you know, hook the attention of the reporter, who's your first audience. And so when you're thinking about trying to get something in the media, you need to think about what that reporter needs. So they need an image that they have permission to use, as we just mentioned. That might be a Creative Commons thing, but a lot of times it's even better to have something that's from you, because that's a unique image. So like I said, these were not professionals, but I think this bat one's pretty good, right? Sometimes you have hidden skills among your team that you can really capitalize on, and people are really excited to use their what might be a kind of a hobby, taking these amazing photographs for something really useful. And so this one on the left, this guy descending into a cave, maybe it's not the most perfect image, but it's doing work for us. It's telling us something about the place where this research took place, which makes it much more feel more real to us. And it's showing something about what that cave looks like. It's not just a little niche in the wall, but it's really deep and hard to get to, which was part of their story, because the fact that this cave is, you know, requires this rappelling down into a hole meant that that record of bat poop was protected. So when you share these images, whether you're doing it through a press release or maybe you're just handing it to a reporter who you've taken the time to create a relationship with, which would be great. You want to make sure that you share that credit, that you have that permission. They may ask you to sign a form, so be prepared to, if you are not the person who took the picture, if it's your friend or someone on your team, that they're ready to sign that form. And you want to provide some information about what's in the image. So don't just give them the picture. Tell them what you want them to know about it. Who's in the picture? What's important about it? And absolutely, who made that image? All right. Let's go on to the next one. And like I was saying, sometimes the uniqueness is more important than the perfection. So this is a really simple video that I'm gonna play. It doesn't even have sound. It's just a time-lapse video that these guys set up a camera while they were going about their work, sampling this water here, which in this case is on the surface of Greenland's ice sheet, but maybe you are doing some sampling in the field with your team. And that could also be interesting. And you can tell this isn't like high res or, you know, super professional looking, but it's doing the work of showing what they were learning, which was about how this water level goes up and down over the course of a day. And it's also just kind of fun to see the people doing their work in the field. People are interested in what you're doing and they're interested in you as a person. You might also want to think about how you can use drawings or animations to talk about things that are hard for us to imagine. So that might be air pollution, you can't see it often, or temperature changes. Or in this case, the authors were trying to talk about how they think they're predicting that Northern Hemisphere summers are going to be longer. The summer weather is going to be longer. And you can tell that this isn't like super, the designer didn't make this. It's not really fancy. They probably did it on whatever they had available on their laptop to make this little picture, but it does a pretty good job of giving you an idea of that temporal change. And then because it's a GIF, it's got that changing time. So it shows how summer was in the past or now and how it's spreading out to take over more of the year. And similarly, like Olivia was talking about drawings, maybe you're not as amazing a painter as the person who made this picture, which is an interstellar object, Oumuamua, something that might be really seem very esoteric or hard for us to imagine, this very distant object that came into our solar system from another solar system, the first one that we know of. And this picture really helped get this story in the news, what was otherwise kind of an obscure story, because it makes it so much more interesting than like just a headline or just a really blurry photo or diagram might be, right? And one of the fun things about this too is that the early reports of it showed this edge on, so people thought it looked like a cigar, but the new researchers saying it's more like a cookie. So they could have fun headlines like cookie from another solar system, it's the chip off of another planet or something like that. I know you guys aren't doing space, but think about where, you know, people you know. I don't think that this was a professional artist. I think this was somebody who worked in space science who was also an artist. He was excited to do this drawing. And finally, like many of you may be working with the kind of information that really has a spatial component, whether that's like water monitoring or like pollution, air pollution, that kind of thing. And a map, if you have the ability to make a map, is a really great way to display that information, much better than like a table of numbers or just telling people, oh, it's gonna be much hotter in New Delhi. This image, you know, is showing where they think heat in the near future is going to be too much for people who are working outside. And the thing to keep in mind when you do this is that you don't make it too complex. You might have like a lot of different factors you wanna show, and you need to think about what is really the most important thing and make sure it's really cleanly labeled and not too complicated. And maybe it's okay to show two maps here like they have, but I wouldn't try to show a reporter eight maps. Maybe if they were really into it and really chatting with you during an interview, you might show them your eight maps. But when you're reaching out to them first, you would think about the thing that you think really encapsulates the idea, the most important thing that they can take away from it. And the other thing that this this person has done really well is that they're showing a gradation of from like the white to the dark color of how intense the effect is, how much heat is increasing. And they've only used one color, which is good. You don't want to use the rainbow color. That's hard for people to interpret. So be simple on that factor too. Just really this nice magenta. Everyone can see magenta, even people who have color blindness. And I think that was all the ideas I really want. I wanted to just give you a quick overview of how we work with images with the press. And like, you know, even when we're working with the scientists, and even though we have a design team here at AGU who are wonderful, a lot of times we're really relying on the folks to give us pictures from the field that'll really humanize the work they're doing, or share with us graphs like this that show, you know, how their data looks on the map. Because it has that uniqueness, and that's exciting for reporters, because if you get them clip art, like, that's just not that exciting. They can find that anywhere. But this is something only you have, and that makes it special, even if it's not like perfection. And I would say even something like that video, they didn't produce it, they didn't put music over it or narration, but in some ways the reporters might like that better, because then they can take it and they can do the production, you know, in the way they want. A lot of times if you've done a lot of production, they'll actually ask you, do you have the raw footage? What I like best about it is really that just the raw experience, like the cell phone footage you took of being at your field site or talking to a person. And I guess we'll have a chance to ask questions later, but I'm gonna turn it over to Liz.
Great, thanks so much. That was an excellent overview, Liza. And I feel like we're gonna have a couple of similar themes in terms of you know, what kind of multimedia is really useful for policymakers. I'm gonna talk about a few different categories, graphics and data visualization first. I'll talk about photos and then social media and you know, video, that kind of thing. So I feel like the best place to start is, you know, what is the point that you really wanna get across? What is the message that you want to get to those policymakers? Start with that and then figure out how you're going to convey that. I really think about what's necessary to share and what isn't, because the more that you can simplify, the bigger impact that you're going to be able to have as you communicate with policymakers. I really like simplification and clarity whenever possible. I think that is the best way to convey something in a way that they're going to be able to share the story with others. They're going to understand it really well, regardless of their background, your background. And then in order to make sure that you're really doing that well, I think it's helpful to show a draft of whatever you're doing to maybe a friend or a family member, someone who isn't involved directly in that project, so that they can take a look at it and give you some feedback and advise you if, okay, maybe this is a little confusing, or the audio cut out a little bit here, I couldn't really understand what's happening. Whatever it might be, you know, for graphics and data visualization in particular, they might give you feedback on what's clear and what isn't in the image, what might need better labeling, or maybe it's too busy and you could pare back a little bit. And similar to what Liza said, clean fonts, high contrast colors, things that are really easy for people to see are always very helpful. So I have just a couple of examples I wanted to share. These that I'm sharing are data visualizations done by one of our wonderful scientists in our Voices for Science program. And he has put together something that's a very simple visually, but conveys a lot of great information. So for this, showcasing the number of US billion-dollar weather and climate disasters since 1980, and then you can see the type of disasters are done in these boxes, and each box is relative to the number of disasters. So you can see drought is much larger than any of the others, right? That jumps right out at you from this visual. And it's very clean and simple, but it makes it really easy to convey something that is, you know, important information that you want to share. So there's not a lot on here. You know, he's showcasing California in particular because he lives in California. And so if you are talking to a policymaker, it would be great to convey, you know, what's happening in that city, state, district, wherever you are policymakers love to see maps. That's really helpful to them to get a sense of what's impacting their communities. Here's another one that has just a little more to it. It's a very simple visualization, but is expanded to a larger area and showcasing top events that cost a high amount of money. So again, it's something that you could pare it down and just have one piece of this because there are a couple different components. But just to give you an idea of something that's pretty clear and concise and easy to understand. And then I'll talk a little bit about photography. We've mentioned this before, but it's great to document all stages of your product with photos, because at some point later on, you may want some of those images from the early stages in order to create that story and showcase what has happened throughout the entire project. So think about what kind of story you can tell by capturing photos at all stages of what you're doing. You can use these with the offices in order to show them what you're doing, give them progress updates. It can be part of sort of a report at the end that you share with them. You know, they're great things to make a visual impact during either a virtual meeting or an in-person meeting. And it's also really important, I think, to take photos of your community when they're working with policymakers. So also share that side of the story. And I have a few illustrations here in my slides. So this is an action shot, obviously. This is one of our scientists who is out in the field collecting fish samples for a project with the local U.S. Wildlife Service. So they captured some of this, and you can see these exciting action shots. Anytime you put an animal in a photo, that's always endearing, right? Doing science with dogs is better than doing science, or, you know, any kind of project is made better with an animal. So that's always a fun thing to capture. Here's a bit of a collage that someone put together on the data gathering aspects. So you can see they're showing the great work they're doing, the number of people that are coming together on this project, the location, some of the tools that they're using, and the fact that they're having fun out there. You know, I think this is a great compilation that you could put together really easily. I mean, clearly this person, you know, did this in like a PowerPoint slide or something that's very simple, and that's perfectly fine. It absolutely gets the point across. That's really all you need. And I would say even in a Zoom environment, even in a virtual world that we are in right now, it's important to capture things. You can see one of the presenters here, is Jessica Taylor right here. She's actually giving a class to a number of teachers in this image. And so you can see everyone's engaged, they're having fun, they're doing this demonstration with her. And it's a great way to showcase the impact that she's having, even in a virtual environment, which you might think, the photos, you know, they're just not the same as in person. They can really tell a story as well. So I would say, go ahead and take them. And then I mentioned earlier, you know, part of what you capture when you're working with policymakers is that interaction itself. You know, here's AGU's former president speaking with a senator. You know, this is one of those things that you also want to capture to be able to showcase the impact that you have been able to have. Here are some of our great scientists who are out on Capitol Hill meeting with policymakers, and they'll be able to share this as part of the bigger project that they were able to accomplish. You know, we were able to meet with these policymakers and we told them all about the great work that we're doing. And then another scientist who's actually testifying, a great opportunity to showcase how you're getting the word out about the important work that you're doing. So let's talk a little bit about social media. When you are trying to engage people in social media, it has been shown that visuals get more people to view and interact with what you're posting. So I highly recommend it. Again, clarity and simplicity is critical, and making your text really concise so it will fit in the constraints. And using your own photos is important, or they talked about the licensing, you know, definitely be aware of that. I love Canva, canva.com. It's free. It's really easy. It looks very professional. They have pre-made templates for just about any social media you might be using, and you can just modify the text and maybe drop in an image. I have a couple of examples. They're great to use. If you are using social media to try and engage policymakers, be sure to tag the policymaker, use their handle. That'll get their attention. And if there's a call to action of any kind, be really clear about what you want people to do. So I have a few examples of these. These are generally things that we have put together. This was made using Canva. You know, we use this stock image and we put the text on top, and we're very specifically saying, this is what we want you to do by taking action here. Here's another one talking about the Landslide Preparedness Act and how we want to ensure that that bill gets passed, and is a very clear kind of call to action here, as well as a simple graphic that we could put together on something like Canva. And this one, let's see if I can get this little animation to play. Great. So this again is done on Canva with a really simple animation that just sort of flips between a couple of images. So basically kind of making your own little video or GIF with the most minimal amount of effort ever, which is very handy. Oops, there we go. Okay. And then here is one more, which we put together using Canva. We had one of our great interns draw this image. And you know, certainly you could do something that's even more simple, but we basically just put together a few different slides and had them play one after the next. And you can actually animate in Canva. And it makes it really easy to do something like this. I also wind up using PowerPoint for a lot of these kinds of things. You know, there are a ton of free and easy software options depending on what you want to try and achieve. Just flipping through here. Okay, and this was a video.
Hello.
Good afternoon. My name is Linda Stapopoulos.
So this is something that a few of our past Voices for Science participants put together, and they did such a wonderful job on this. They all recorded this from home. I think they all did their own Zoom videos, and then one person volunteered to weave them together. But they were able to have this great message where they asked policymakers to fund science strongly. And they just kind of wove the little narrative together, each saying hello, who they are, why they think it's really important for scientists to, or for policymakers to fund science. And you could do something like this for any kind of topic where you have maybe a couple of different people who are involved in your project who all come together and talk about how important it was, what you're able to achieve. And really there's not a ton of additional work that needs to be done on this, as long as you know you have one person who's willing to do a little editing. So I think it can have such an impact. What they did with this is they posted this video on social media, and they were able to get a number of policymakers to see it by tagging them. But I won't play the whole thing, but that is a few ways that I think are really valuable for working with policymakers in terms of some kind of, you know, visual, audio, video, et cetera. So I hope that was helpful, and I'm gonna hand it back over for closing up.
Thank you all. Are there any questions? Or rather, what questions are there? I'm sure there are questions. Any reflections? I really appreciated Marilyn's comment earlier that some of this is really hard to apply right now just because you have limited capacity. And that's something we're really looking into figuring out how we can support you more on. We'd love to hear what you thought of today's presentation, what you'd like to hear more of, what would really help you create greater impact in the work that you're doing. Right. Well, if anybody wants to share their question, please speak up or put it in the chat. Marilyn, I will make the recording available as soon as it processes, so within the next few days, and we'll send around a summary of all those resources that were mentioned. A couple of things. There are next science policy and engagement our workshop is coming up on June 23rd, again on a Wednesday from 3 to 5 p.m. And we'll be focusing on how to get your communities mobilized to be involved in the work that you're doing, to be talking with policymakers, to just get engaged in that science and help you have that impact that you're looking for. On July 14th, also 3 to 5 p.m. on a Wednesday, we will be meeting with a variety of journalists and policymakers and hearing really from them what they need to hear from you to have the sort of impact that you're looking for. Our sixth and final workshop is still TBD. So if there's something you really want to learn about, please let us know and we'd be happy to create the content to support you there. So feel free to email any of us at any point and let us know what you think, any feedback on these workshops. And I'd just like to remind you all that you are part of a special cohort that is externally funded by the Moore Foundation. There is project funding available up to $10,000 for each project to help your projects move forward. So if you need funding for sensors or for lab tests or for sketches of various plans, which is something one of our communities has used some of that funding for, let me know. You all have the emails for how to request that funding. It's very simple. We just need to make sure you're not, you know, donating it to politicians or anything. Really trying to build project impact with those funds. So let us know that money is for you. We want you to use it, preferably this year. And with that, I'd like to really thank Shane, Olivia, Liza, and I'm missing somebody.
Liz.
Liz, thank you. Everybody just shifted. I was like, ah. Thank you all very much. This was an excellent webinar. Really open for questions at this point.
Just had a quick question. It's not as fun. It deals with social media and public records. Are there any times that you should be concerned? One of the issues I think that we have in our office is we go back and forth on whether we should be using stories or not. Because there's some benefits to using just stories like on Facebook and Instagram, but they're not necessarily recorded for public record from what I understand. I think it's, we can get them in Facebook, but I don't know if it's recording that metadata, and I don't really even understand that, but I guess that can be used for legal purposes or whatever. So I know some of the things we usually post are usually more lighthearted, but I wasn't sure if you had an opinion on that.
I'm happy to, this is Haley McKee, by the way. I'm Thriving Earth Exchange's very brand new program manager for communications, but I'm happy to speak to a little part of this, if that makes sense. And I invite Liza and other folks to comment as well. When you say, in like using stories and metadata, are you like concerned about like sharing information that you are not sure if you can share, or what's the main concern that you have?
Well, we use Social Archive to make sure that all of our social media platforms are archived, basically. So if someone should come back for a public records request, that we have it and we can supply it. So that's where we were wondering if using stories for Facebook or Instagram was a good idea, because when they're gone, they're gone. So that's, we just wanted it more for the public records end of it.
I see. When you say, you mean Instagram stories as in, yeah, the ones that are there and then they go away. Yeah. You know, I think that that's a really good question. I think that, yeah, the keeping an archive of the materials that you have, I think that it's going to kind of depend on what the content is and, you know, whether you archive it or not, like using the platform and then I think that overall storing the social media content that you produce is usually your best bet just in case and keeping those archives and using that function. But there may also be things where, you know, you have an event announcement and then you let it go away into the ether, like it's not a big deal. And also thinking about where else and what other platforms are you sharing that information where it might also be publicly available and be kind of present forever. I invite other folks to comment on this as well, but even when you're using something like Instagram stories or, you know, in the past, things like Snapchat, nothing is ever truly, once it's on the internet, it's kind of there forever. It just may be a little more involved to find it. So I think if you take that approach, you should be in a good position to always feel good about what you're posting and what you're letting go away and what you're storing.
Yeah, I mean, it's safe to assume that from the negative perspective, your stuff will never disappear. But that from the positive perspective of wanting to maintain it, you, yes, might need to put a little more effort into making sure that it's available and archived in a way that makes it accessible to you or to whatever audience you want to reach.
Thank you. I appreciate the information.
And I'd just like to point out the project pages that we have at the Thriving Earth Exchange website. You are welcome to archive a lot of materials there. And some projects have used that. They've been used even in court cases just to show here's the evolution of the project. So that's always a resource available to you. Those project pages are really for you, your team.
I think there's a question for you in the chat, Erin.
Are visual products created about our Thriving Earth Exchange products intellectual property of text or the project leaders who created the pieces? We ask for your permission to share them, but they're your intellectual property. Your fellow has probably bugged you a number of times to get those photo release forms. It's just so that we can share those if you want them on your project page. Your project page, again, is for you. We like to at least be able to say that, you know, this team is doing this project in this location, more or less about this topic. The level of detail after that point, and I'm being kind of fast and loose with my vocabulary here, we do want some detail because it's important for us to be able to show what projects are being done. But at a point, the level of detail depends entirely on you. We really depend on you to tell us what you want on that project page. What other questions? Again, any thoughts on what you'd like to hear in future workshops are very, very welcome. You have the dream team here in terms of communications. So. And I definitely exclude myself. All right. With that, I wish you all a wonderful rest of your Wednesday. And hopefully we'll see everybody in a month.
Yeah.
I thank you.